comes from the New
Testament book of Matthew, is chapter 13, 1 through 9, and verses 18 through 23. And I'll read those in a few minutes.
Today's sermon is titled,
How Does Your Garden Grow? So I'll start this sermon with a short five-statement garden quiz. Statement number one, true or false, newly planted seeds should be kept in soggy soil.
Answer, false.
Damp soil is best. Statement number two, fruits can be grown indoors. Answer,
true. My grandmother grew
strawberries indoors in two large wash tubs. Statement number three, again true or false, watering on a sunny day can burn holes in plant leaves. Answer, false. Holes in leaves are due to fungal or bacterial diseases and have nothing to do with the sun shining on water droplets. Statement four, plants need room to grow. Answer, true.
You could actually crowd
plants to death. And last, statement number five, the tomato is a fruit. True or false?
That is true. The tomato is a fruit since it developed from a flower
and has seeds on the inside, even though it doesn't share the flavor characteristics of other fruits.
How'd you do?
Did you get all five right? Well, I don't remember exactly where I got these five statements. It was either from Square Foot Gardening or HGTV Online. So if you have a problem with those, you have to take it up with them. Okay, my grandma used to plant a big, I mean a big, vegetable garden every year. Although I much rather prefer playing neighborhood baseball, I did help her out far more than I wanted to. And what we planted, and weeded, and watered, and harvested, we ate, and also shared with our neighbors. But my grandma also canned in mason jars nearly every vegetable we grew. Peas,
tomatoes, green beans, you name it, she canned it. Well, after graduating
from college and moving away from home, I continued gardening on a much, much smaller scale. So I've always enjoyed this morning's scripture where Jesus tells a parable about gardening. I ask that you listen as I read this scripture from Matthew's Gospel. That same day, Jesus went out of the house and set beside the sea. Such great crowds gathered around him that he got into a boat and sat there, while the whole crowd stood on the beach. And he told them many things in parables, saying, listen, a sower went out to sow. And as he sowed, some seeds fell on the path, and the birds came and ate them. Other seeds fell on rocky ground, where they did not have much soil, and they sprang up quickly, since they had no depth of soil. But when the sun rose, they were scorched, and since they had no root, they withered away. Other seeds fell among thorns, and the thorns grew up and choked them. Other seeds fell on good soil and brought forth grain, some 100-fold, some 60, some 30. If you have ears, hear.
Hear, then, the parable of the sower.
When anyone hears the word of the kingdom and does not understand it, the evil one comes and snatches away what is sown in the heart. This is what was sown on the path. As for what was sown on the rocky ground, this is the one who hears the word and immediately receives it with joy. Yet such a person has no root, but endures only a short while. And when trouble or persecution arises on account of the word, that person immediately falls away. As for what was sown among thorns, this is one who hears the word, but the cares of this age and the lure of wealth choke the word, and it yields nothing. But as for what was sown on good soil, this is the one who hears the word and understands it, who indeed
bears fruit on yields in
one case 100-fold, in another 60, and another 30. Jesus tells us that the sown seed, in this parable is the word of God. And we, more specifically our hearts, we are the soil.
In this parable, Jesus
identifies four types of hearts: the stony heart, the shallow heart, the strangled heart, and the surrendered heart. Let's take a closer look at all four of these. First, the stony heart. This is a hardened heart. It can be hardened by any number of things: a lost love, a broken relationship, a friend's betrayal, a dried out spirit even, a spirit that has said no to God. No one, nothing, is going to
more so a bitter heart.
A heart that is totally surrendered to the world, not to God. In a stony heart, the seed of God's word gets gobbled up by worldly desires before it even has a chance to settle.
In the movie Secondhand Life,
young Walter, played by Haley Joel Osment, is on his way to be dumped off, yes, dumped off, by his mother at the home of his only living relatives. His mother will head off then to find herself a new husband, while Walter is left to fend for himself with two very eccentric uncles. These uncles are Hub and Garth, played by Robert Duvall and Michael Caine. When Walter arrives, he finds them both sitting on the front porch. As his mom drives away, Walter asks, "If my mom calls, can we hear the telephone out here?" Garth roughly says, "Don't have one." Shocked, Walter says, "No phone?" Then he asks, "Is it okay if I go inside and watch television?" Garth roughly says, "Ain't got one." Walter cannot believe it. He cannot believe no phone, no TV. Well, about that time, a car pulls up, the long drive. A traveling salesman jumps out and starts his spiel. Hub and Garth both reach for a shotgun and shoot over the salesman's head as he quickly jumps in his car and drives away. At the beginning of the movie,
these two men clearly demonstrate
a stony heart, a heart which nothing is going to penetrate.
Well, next is a shallow heart.
A heart incapable of deep feeling, a heart with little focus and virtually no vision.
This is a heart which
has some enthusiasm, but no commitment. A prime example of one with a shallow heart is the rich young man found in Matthew 19, verses 16 through
22. When he asks what he must do
to attain eternal life, Jesus tells him straight on, "Sell all your possessions and give to the poor, and you will be assured of treasure in heaven."
The rich young man quickly
turns and walks away. This is a heart open to the seed, that is to say,
God's word,
but makes no promise to do so. Pastor Billy Strayhorn tells the story of a very small community church building that was shared by four different religious denominations, each having access one Sunday a month. The first Sunday of the month was the Methodist service because they, as we do, practice open communion on that first Sunday. Second Sunday was Southern Baptist. Third Sunday was Presbyterian, and the fourth Sunday was Church of Christ. When there was a fifth Sunday, which happens about four times a year, all four congregations came together for Sunday school and a potluck lunch. Each year, each denomination would have a week-long revival in the building. In this small community, there was a man who just absolutely loved revivals. Didn't have much of a deep commitment to Christ, but he loved revivals. And every time the evangelist came to do a revival, he was there. And he was the first one to head to the altar when the invitation was given.
He would get up there, kneel down, spread out his
arms, and at the loudest voice he had, "Fill me up," he would say. "Fill me up, Jesus, fill me up." Every revival, the same thing, over and over again. Well, after seven revivals, and after he said it, "Fill me up, Jesus, fill me up," a woman stood up and said, "Don't do it, Lord, he leaks." I think that's what Jesus meant by the shallow heart. It's the soil of both the heart and the soul that's so shallow that seed really doesn't take root, but rather becomes scorched in the light of everyday living for oneself. This heart over time may well wither and die. The third is the strangled heart. This is the heart that is filled with faith. It has deep roots, quickly springs up, and grows. Unfortunately, it tries to grow, but only where it has always grown. As a result, it oftentimes gets easily distracted. And there's a lot, folks, to be distracted about in this world today. We have more choices in all aspects of our day-to-day lives today than we've had at any other time in our history. I don't know about you, but I have well over 300 TV channels from which to choose.
Instead of downsizing, many
companies make more and more choices each and every year. As I walk down the grocery aisle, I see more than 50 blends of coffee, more than 50 different kinds of breakfast cereals, and 75 different kinds of soup at my fingertips. In 1996, Nathan Bob Nathaniel became the United Methodist Bishop of Northern Conference of the Dominican Republic in Congo in Africa. He served in that capacity for 20 years. United Methodist bishops have to do mission trips every other year.
This responsibility brought him
to the United States of America for his very first time 8 years ago.
He told about getting off the
plane and realized soon that he'd forgotten his toothpaste. So he went into our all-American supermarket and was amazed at how many toothpaste brands and how many different kinds of toothpaste was there.
He said, in my home country,
we have one, Colgate. That's it. Folks, there are restaurants in this town that have a six-page menu.
In some countries, people
don't even have a choice of what to eat. They eat what they're given.
In fact, some don't even have
a choice of whether they need to eat today or not. Here's where we're blessed in this country with so much. The number of choices oftentimes becomes a major distraction, though, oftentimes strangling our heart. Well, the fourth and final heart is the surrender heart. This is a hopeful heart, a joyful heart. This is a heart that is most like the heart of God. You see, the sower in this scripture passage is anything but frugal. Early American farmers were careful with their seed. Seed was expensive.
Planting was done with
care, so as not to lose even a single seed.
Seed wasn't thrown
everywhere like the sower in today's scripture. This sower was a bit wasteful, and maybe that's part of Jesus' point. As I said earlier, the scripture is about our hearts being the soil to grow the seed, which is God's word, put it in us so that we can bear fruit.
But also about
it's about God loving us, who blesses us beyond all measure, a God who continues to scatter the best seed, his word, to a world where there are stony hearts, shallow hearts, and straggling hearts. You know, our God is an extravagant God. And what I mean by that, he is a God who blesses us beyond all measure, despite the fact that we rarely deserve any of the blessings that we receive.
But we rejoice in
the fact that we have a God who sows the seed of his love also in places that may not, and quite probably won't ever, ever take root and produce any fruit at all. But remember, we believe in a God of miracles, and sometimes that's exactly what happens. The seed does take root.
The seed isn't gobbled up or dried out
or even strangled. The seed takes root.
It blooms and prospers. And when that happens,
God rejoices and uses that seed as an example of just how amazing his grace truly is.
God's grace
can change a stony, a shallow, and a strangled heart into a surrendered heart.
This is the heart that makes
a difference in
our world today.
Dr. Keith Wagner of St. Paul's United Church of Christ in Sydney, Ohio, tells the story of a small boy in his church some years ago. It seemed this young boy heard that the Russians were our enemy. He began to wonder about Russian children his age. He found it hard to believe that they could be an enemy
of his. So he sat down and wrote a short
note, and it read, "Dear comrade in Russia, I'm 7 years old, and I believe that we can live together in peace. I want you to be my friend, not my enemy. Will you become my friend and write to me?" He closed the letter saying, "Love and peace," and signed his name. He then neatly
folded that note,
put it into an empty bottle, and threw it into a lake, if you will,
near his home. Well, several years
later, a bottle and note was retrieved by a person on a nearby beach. The story about the note appeared in a local newspaper, and the media picked it up, and it went nationwide. A group of people from New Hampshire, not Ohio, who were taking children to the Soviet Union as ambassador of peace, read the article. They contacted the boy and his family and invited them to accompany them when they went to Russia. The 7-year-old boy and his father traveled with them to Russia.
One little boy made a difference.
God seemed to plant it in his heart, and it most certainly bore fruit. It doesn't take much, folks, if that seed is initially
planted in a surrendered heart. I'll close by asking you
a simple question. Which heart do you
possess? The stony heart, the shallow heart, the strangled heart, or